The year is 1984. Italian director Sergio Leone, best known for his Western films The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, and Once Upon a Time in the West, has premiered his latest film at the Cannes Film Festival, Once Upon a Time in America. America marked a major departure for the director. It was not another Western, the genre that had become well known for, but in fact a crime epic, and one that Leone had spent over a decade working on. At first, it appeared that Leone's work had paid off. America received an unheard-of 20-minute standing ovation that could be heard throughout the city. Unfortunately, this positive response fell on deaf ears in the US. Once Upon a Time in America had a runtime of almost 4 hours, making it the longest Hollywood production since Bernardo Bertolucci's Novecento in 1976. For the Ladd Company, one of the companies funding the project, this was unacceptable. They were in dire need of a hit, as their previous film, The Right Stuff, while critically acclaimed, did not make a profit at the box office. Leone's contract stipulated that he deliver an 165-minute cut of the film, but he refused to edit it any further. But when test audiences were unhappy with the film's length and unconventional structure, the studio decided to edit Once Upon a Time in America themselves. The final product was 144 minutes in length and universally reviled by critics. Leone pursued legal action against the company, but was unsuccessful. Every time he found someone responsible, they would be fired, promoted, or disappear completely. As Leone fought to get his film a proper release, he began to work on other projects. There was A Place Only Mary Knows, a Civil War film to star Richard Gere and Mickey Rourke, and Cult, a television series following the many owners of a single called Pistol. But among these projects was one far greater in scope. It was Leone's most ambitious project to date, and one that would encapsulate all the skills he had obtained as a filmmaker. This would be Leningrad, The 900 Days. Much like Once Upon a Time in America, the origins of Leningrad began well over a decade before Leone began to actively pursue it. In 1969, while headed to New York to look for potential investors for America, Leone bought a book. This was Harrison E. Salisbury's The 900 Days, The Siege of Leningrad, which had been recently published. During the Second World War, Salisbury had been a foreign correspondent for the New York Times. He was one of the few Westerners who was in the city of Leningrad during the siege and provided a first-hand account of the horrific conditions the people endured. There was mass starvation, below-freezing temperatures, and a seemingly never-ending air raid that decimated the city. By the time the siege had ended in 1944, over a million civilians had died. As the book was in English, Fulvio Marcella, who worked with Leone on several films, read the book to him. Leone was enthralled by the story and began to consider ideas for a feature film. In an interview with Marlene Glickman in 1987, Leone provided some additional information on the project's origin. The original idea was this amazing story of the city of Leningrad holding out against the Germans, almost destroying themselves, consuming themselves to hold out against the Germans. But I don't want to do a war film per se, nor do I want to do a political film. It's a little hard to avoid putting both war and politics in, and that they both come into the activity, but on their own. My basic idea is to do a great love film set in the hell of 1942. At that moment, hell was Leningrad. Leone had also listened to composer Dmitri Shostakovich's Leningrad Symphony. The composition itself began development 3 months after the Nazi invasion of the Soviet Union. In addition, Leone saw two photographs from the siege that would cement his idea. The first featured Shostakovich in a fireman's helmet on the roof of the Leningrad Music Conservatory. The second had the composer in an empty theater listening to a piece of music. Coupled with some newsreel footage of Shostakovich at work in an unbelievable opening sequence, Leone began to pitch the project to the Soviet Union. However, the Soviet Union's relationship with the Western world was not very good. Although they were happy that a film was going to be made about their country, there were certain elements about the Siege of Leningrad that worried them. Specifically, the political content that might insult the government's handling of the events. When the war ended, Joseph Stalin forbade any attempt at making a film about Leningrad, likely because he arrested many of the government officials who saved the city. There were newsreels, of course, and even a handful of documentaries and television projects, but no movie. Not to mention, the slow bureaucracy continually frustrated Leone. Much like with Once Upon a Time in America, it was difficult to gain any ground when he rarely met the same government official twice, and those that he did meet would try to convince him to pursue other projects. One of which was the Warren Beatty film Reds, which was about the October Revolution, but Leone was adamant on a film about Leningrad. He wanted to tell a love story, one involving an American newsreel cameraman and a Soviet woman, with the siege as the background. The cameraman would have originally gone there for 20 days to cover the battle. He is a very cynical man and does not understand the magnitude of the war. But by seeing the sacrifice of the people defending their city, he decides to stay there for the entire siege. Love, of course, was a major reason for this. Leone described it as a lost love, lost in hell. Think of Gone with the Wind, a love story against the background of a war. This will be a huge cinematic fresco, at least 3 hours screen time. There will not be an emphasis on the war, although I asked for 400 tanks, I will be requiring at least 2,000. What Leone had in mind wouldn't have been out of place in his filmography. The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly was set during the Civil War, and Duck, You Sucker was set during the Mexican Revolution. The difference in Leningrad's case was the massive scale it required. This could not be shot in a somewhat similar-looking city or a Hollywood set. It would require filming in the actual city and featured the people who lived in it. This was why Leone was so adamant about getting Soviet permission for the film. In fact, he would have been the very first Hollywood director given permission to film a significant part of the country's history. However, none of these setbacks deterred Leone. Whenever he had the opportunity, he spoke of Leningrad, and by the release of Once Upon a Time in America, it was looking more and more possible. As Leone was making America, he learned that his films had been immensely popular in the Soviet Union. In the meantime, Mikhail Gorbachev became the next General Secretary. In what was known as the Glasnost, he began to thaw the tensions that had been building up in the early 80s. Things were starting to move in Leone's favor. On one of his many trips to Moscow, the Supreme Soviet of Film Production had asked him if he was interested in making a movie with them. Leone suggested making a film about Leningrad. Most Film, one of the largest studios in the USSR, gave permission as well, but they wanted to see a script before a deal was signed. They also wanted to make sure it will keep politics out of the story, and Salisbury himself will not collaborate on the script. Salisbury was not a very popular figure in the country. The 900 Days had never even been published there, with the reason being, according to the Russian newspaper Pravda, that Salisbury had demeaned the role of the Communist Party in the city's defense and overemphasized the heroism of the people. Behind the scenes, Russian director Elam Klimov was supporting Leone, and due to his standing as the head of the Union of Filmmakers, Leone's project was slowly working towards being greenlit. Even the Italian minister was working with Leone to get the Soviet government interested. Fortunately, their efforts paid off. Leone announced at a press conference in Moscow that a co-production deal had finally been signed between three major Russian studios, Soviet Film, Soviet Export Film, and Len Film Studios. In addition, Leone's own corporation and the Ryan Italy would fund the project. Leone says to have planned on casting Robert De Niro in the role of the cameraman. Although De Niro denied having been approached for the role, he did recall Leningrad being discussed on the set of Once Upon a Time in America. For the other characters, Leone thought of there being two or three other Americans, a team of Germans, and many Russians. Ennio Morricone would naturally return to compose the score, although the Leningrad Symphony would be prominently featured. Morricone even put together an arrangement of the symphony. There would also be Leone's frequent cinematographer, Tonino Delicoli. Further visits to Moscow helped Leone to craft his vision. He discovered a historical account by Daniil Grenin and Alex Adamovic called The Book of the Siege. This book told the story of the siege day by day by 200 survivors. At this time, however, there was nothing written down. All the ideas that Leone had were only in his head. Leone was also considering what writers to work with. There was Alvin Sargent, who had written several successful films such as Ordinary People and Julia. Arnold Yanovic Vital, who had written a television film about the siege, would likely be the official Soviet writer on the team, according to Leone. Leonardo Benvenuti and Piero De Bernardi, who had previously worked with Leone on America, may also join. Why so many writers? Well, for one, Leone would require at least a year of research on the project, with 6 months spent in the city of Leningrad itself. Following that would be the actual writing of the script with the Russian collaborators over a six-month period. Finally, the film would be shot over another 6 months. In total, the project would have taken over 2.5 years to reach completion. It cannot be understated how impressive this work was at the time. Not only did Leone succeed in negotiating with the Russians on his own behalf, using much of his own money as well, yet he was able to raise $15 million worth of investments based solely on the opening scene and his sheer personal magnetism. But there was still much more money required. Initial estimates by Leone put the project around $30 million, assuming that he would have had complete cooperation with the Soviet Union. However, these costs escalated to $100 million, which would have made it the most expensive film ever made at the time. But none of this concerned Leone, and over the following years, he became a highly visible figure in the Italian film scene. He attended many film festivals, wrote for several publications, and was vocal about his thoughts on the current state of Italian cinema. Unfortunately, in 1988, Leone's health started to waver. He seemed to be getting more tired, and there were talks of him possibly getting a heart transplant. The late Morricone recounted that, "Leningrad was the first of our projects about which he didn't want to talk with me. He knew he was going to die." He'd been advised to have a transplant, his sole chance maybe, but he refused. Nevertheless, Leone was adamant on continuing his work, going as far as to shoot a television commercial in Zimbabwe in January of 1989. Earlier that month, Leone announced at a press conference that he had signed a contract with the State Committee and several Russian film companies to start pre-production. Gorbachev had even given Leone the go-ahead to use the Red Army for the film. Leone joked that he hoped to not destroy Leningrad a second time over. In February of 1989, Eleonora Volpe joined the project. It's thanks to her that a lot of other information came to light about the last few months of work on the project. Volpe was a student of the Gerasimov Institute of Cinematography in Moscow, and caught Leone's attention with her showreel. Leone had been looking for an aide who was able to speak Russian and could provide an insight to the Russian people that not many had. It was important for him to understand their soul, mentality, and customs in order to represent them credibly on the screen. He wanted to represent the reality as it was back then, to make a truthful portrait of the people who were able to stand so firmly against the enemy and to give their lives so generously to save their country. Volpe would also help to gather a lot of archival material in Moscow that most countries had not seen before. Copies of archival footage, photographs, and first-hand accounts were translated to Italian and sent to Rome for Leone to read. For a massive undertaking like Leningrad, Leone would need some help with the filming process, and thus look to other directors for the additional units. Volpe would be one of the unit directors alongside Leone's son Andre, but Leone was considering another major director to help. This director was Sergei Bondarchuk, who was well known in the Soviet Union and in the US for his adaptation of War and Peace. Leone even joked that it would be a film made by two Sergios. How seriously this was considered isn't known. Volpe stated that Bondarchuk was flattered by the proposal, he loved Leone's films, but he didn't think the collaboration would actually happen. He believed that it was rather a diplomatic proposal, and that successful films should be made by one director only. She also mentioned that Leone was looking through the most popular Russian actresses at the time. Ludmila Savileva, best known for her role as Natasha in Bondarchuk's War and Peace, was a likely candidate for the female lead. Sadly, on April 30th, 1989, all of this hard work came to an end. On that day, Leone passed away from a heart attack. He had been resting at his home in Rome with his wife Carla, and was about to head to Los Angeles on May 2nd with his son Andre and Attilio D'Onofrio. The plan was to discuss an American investment deal for Leningrad and officially begin pre-production. After Leone's death, there were at least three directors who could have taken up the reins. The first of them was Jean Choconut. Before Leone's death, the two discussed the Leningrad project. If, in Leone's words, something were to happen, he wanted Anu to take up the reins. Anu recounted that, "A few days after his death, the producer Alexander called me to tell me that Sergio wanted me to cover the 900 days of Leningrad. I then asked him if he has a script, and he replies that he only has a suitcase of books on the subject, so I had to give up." Although Anu didn't make a film about the siege, he would make a film about the Battle of Stalingrad many years later. There was also Paul Verhoeven. In a Dutch article from May 2, 1990, producer Alberto Grimaldi stated that Verhoeven would start production the next year. However, the article is unclear if it would have been based on Leone's ideas or just an original story entirely. Nevertheless, there was no further mention of the project after the release of Verhoeven's next film, Total Recall. Finally, there was Alex Cox, director of Repo Man and Sid and Nancy. Leone had been a major influence on Cox's work, and upon hearing of his death, he contacted Lee Katz if there was a search for a replacement director. Katz, whose completion bond company was bonding the film, said they were, and it can be you. All you have to do is come up with $50 million. Unfortunately, Cox was unable to gather the remaining funds and pursued other projects. Things would remain quiet until 2003, when Giuseppe Tornatore, the director of Cinema Paradiso, announced that he would direct the film. Nicole Kidman was in discussions to play a role in the project, and Morricone was slated to compose the score. However, despite saying that filming would begin relatively soon, there wasn't any further word until 2011. At the Cannes Film Festival, producer Avi Lerner and production company Millennium/New Image had signed on to the project. The budget was set at $100 million and the film was to begin shooting in December 2012. Nicole Kidman was no longer in talks for the project, but Al Pacino was rumored to be involved. Yet things were still uncertain. By 2013, Tornatore announced that either in 2 months I'll be at work, or this time I'll be giving up forever. The latter would be the case. And in 2018, he announced that the project was officially cancelled. His work would not go to waste, though. That year, Tornatore released a book about the project, chronicling the many attempts at the production and even included his screenplay. The main issues he listed for derailing the film were the high costs, the lack of American characters, and the idea to shoot the film in segments in order to show the protagonists gradually losing weight. In closing, Tornatore said, "I hope someday someone will make a film about the siege of Leningrad, but it won't be my story." As previously mentioned, Leone had not yet developed the screenplay or an outline for the project. What he did have was a general outline for the story and a handful of ideas for scenes and characters. This included 2 pages of material that Leone showed to the Soviet authorities. The most well-known of these was his plan for the opening sequence. It was to be a one-take to end all one-takes. The sequence, as remembered by Leone's biographer Christopher Frayling, is as follows.
"We start, Christopher, with Shostakovich's hands. And the camera goes back from the hands through a net curtain, and we realize we're in a helicopter. And the helicopter goes to the left past this block of apartments, and next to it are all these people in Leningrad getting up at the beginning of a day to go to work and to go to the front. So here's a tram and some trucks, and the siege is on, so there's all these images of an inferno of a siege, you know, cannibalism, corpses burning, people trying to dismember their pets, you know, dead relatives being pulled along in the snow, an absolute Dantean inferno of the siege. The camera goes to the left. This is one shot. The camera goes to the left. We've had the block of flats. We've had all this teeming life. The trams go round. They go to the edge of the city, where the people get off the trams, get into the trucks. The camera continues going left. The trucks go to the river. The camera goes across the river, where there's an entire panzer division of 200 tanks. The camera is still going to the left. One shot. And it goes right up to the panzer tank commander, to his two eyes through goggles. And the voice says, fire! The camera goes blank. A Sergio Leone film."
It's little wonder how Leone was able to enthrall investors with such a sequence, but the difficulty in capturing it was unparalleled. Delicoli warned Leone that camera magazines at the time could only hold 300 meters of film. The reel would be finished mid-shot. Not to mention, the idea of capturing well over 100 tanks would have been borderline impossible. But Leone was committed to doing it. There's not much known about the love story aspect, but one of the many problems the couple would have faced was the fact that their relationship was illegal. In the Soviet Union at the time, any resident caught having a relationship with an outsider would immediately have been imprisoned. Yet the two continued their romance nonetheless, and even have a child. Sadly, on the day that the city is liberated, the cameraman will be killed as he records the final battle. The woman learns of his death watching a newsreel in the cinema. She recognizes his distinctive shooting style, and then the lens jumps, and she knows that he is dead. For Leone, this may be even more pessimistic than my other films, and I will touch on things I've never attempted before. Although whether or not this would have been the ending is uncertain. Stories naturally change as they're developed, and Leone gave an alternate version in other tellings. "This will be a film about life, not death," he said. "The heart is always the finest part of a hero, and my hero, believed dead, will live at the end. Is cinema, or is it not, a grand illusion?" As for the rest of the plot, Leone wanted to shoot several smaller storylines that were parallel to the central story. Some would be real figures that lived in Leningrad at the time, while others would be based on them. As Volpe noted, this was why he needed more than one unit director. The multiple storylines would all be tied together through the female lead. The characters would be relatives, friends, and neighbors of hers, as they all lived in the same common house. It would also depict the Road of Light, which was an ice road over the nearby Lake Ladoga. It is only when the lake had frozen over several feet that supplies could finally be brought over to Leningrad and citizens could evacuate. The effect that these scenes would have had on audiences would have been unmatched for a mainstream film on the Second World War. Steven Spielberg's Schindler's List may be the closest film to reaching Leone's vision in this way. Although Leone's ideas were magnificent and are a fantastic starting point for a film, I'm unsure if Leningrad could be made today. Sure, there are many technical aspects about the film that could be easily done today, but that doesn't mean the story could easily be recreated. Perhaps one day there will be a director who could revive the project and bring it as close to Leone's original vision as possible, although who knows when that day will come. But that does not mean that a film about the Siege of Leningrad should not be made. With World War II remaining one of the most explored subjects in film, perhaps there's room for a film about the Siege of Leningrad.